Oh, so boy.
Okay, well, this morning it's a nice, well, it's, more, it's better than last week, and we do have nice tropical weather finally for the plants we're going to be talking about today. So we'll start off with papayas, which, you know, all the things we're talking about are associated with Hawaii, but they're all from either from Mexico or South America. So they're all American type plants. Papayas generally have been difficult to grow in this area, and except for, I would say, the last 5 years, it's been pretty easy. We haven't had as much cold in the winters as we've had in the past, so global warming would help us grow papayas much better, because they don't like to be below 80 degrees. They like it 80 degrees and above day and night, which we're getting these days quite a bit of weather of that. So papaya is native to central, southern Mexico and Central America. They're put in their own family, but I've got to believe that these are related to the cucurbits, the melon, cucumber, squash family, because they resemble it so closely in their foliage and their flowers and a particular disease. So there is a disease out there called papaya ring spot virus, which is a major problem. I started growing papayas back in the 1980s, and the plants look fine. First year grew about this tall. Second year they grew about this tall. No sign of any flowers or fruit. And some of my friends from Hawaii were over and they said, "Oh, your papaya plants look better than ours. Where's the fruit?" And by the third year, we got a few flowers and a few small fruit formed, and they were pretty lousy. And I thought, and after 5 years of doing it, I'm going, okay, can't grow papayas. What's wrong? Plants look good, fruit's terrible, no luck. So I cut them all down, planted other fruit trees, and then that was in the 80s. And in the 90s, I read about papaya ring spot virus, and I've been told by people who maybe know stuff or don't know stuff that, no, papaya ring spot virus doesn't occur in California. We don't grow papayas here. But, you know, what we had was the correct symptoms. They said, can you get papayas, get papaya ring spot virus, the plant grows, but it makes about 1/10 normal crop, and the crop is lousy. So instead of getting about 30 fruit a year, I was getting 3 lousy papayas a year. It wasn't worth growing. So we figured they had the ring spot virus. So we looked on the internet in the late 90s and saw that the University of Hawaii had gotten together with Cornell University and developed immune papayas. Papayas are immune to the ring spot. It took them a long time because plants do not have immune systems like people do. So in people, if you have a virus, and the ring spot is a virus, you just cook the virus, which breaks into little pieces, shoot it into the person. It's dead virus, but it's pieces of the virus. The body thinks it's the disease, becomes immune to it, so if the virus ever shows up again, your body's already got an immune system, but plants don't have that. They tried it anyway, and it wasn't working. They're trying different avenues of trying to control this virus. What was happening in Hawaii is that each, one by one, the islands are getting infected, so they're having to move their papaya plantations to more different islands. They said they're on their last island when Cornell and University of Hawaii decided they'd better do something about this disease because they didn't have any more land left that was not infected. So anyway, what worked, interestingly, was they took that dead virus and shot it into the nucleus of a cell. And it wouldn't catch the virus. They don't know why it works, but because they shot it into the nucleus, it's now considered genetically modified, even though it's just a copy of the virus that's already in there. The EPA okayed it for use right away because they said, well, if you take the fruit from a virus-infected plant, like I eat virus-infected fruit, each cell of that fruit contains up to 70, 7,000 copies of that virus, whereas if you only have one copy of the nucleus, it's much better, a foreign gene. So he said, yeah, the genetically modified papaya plants contain much less of that virus DNA, or RNA, whatever it is that viruses carry, than the genetically modified ones. So we're going to okay this, but still, at this time, you know, there are people protesting the plantations in Hawaii that grow this thing. The Hawaiian one is called Rainbow. The one that they created for Hawaii is Rainbow Papaya. And they, you know, they keep saying bad things about it because when they created the first virus-protected papaya, it was highly susceptible to mildew. They said, oh, this GMO papaya, there's something wrong with it. So what they did is they took that one, they crossed it with the normal papaya and got the rainbow papaya. So rainbow papaya has it's two chromosomes in the cells of those things. One chromosome is virus protected and one is not. When they cross the original virus protected one with another papaya. So the rainbow has two chromosomes, one protects it from the virus, one doesn't. So, but it is protected. So the rainbow, now unfortunately, we can't get the seeds for rainbow. They won't sell it. Now, other countries around the world are having the same problem. Now, the papaya ring spot virus has apparently originated in India, made all the way around the world. And the one thing that it does too, it also infects cucurbits. So squash, melons, watermelons, they can all catch this virus, but it doesn't hurt. It doesn't seem to affect them at all. And that's the problem why we have this virus, is because the squash plant you already may have it. And they're just, and an aphid comes suck on that and comes to your young papaya plant suck on a leaf, and suddenly this has it too. So that's the reason we're getting it. Even though we don't have a papaya industry here, there's so many cucurbits being grown that disease is all around us. And if you don't have a protected papaya plant, then you can run into trouble. Now, it is true there are a lot of papayas that can catch it and still make decent fruit. The Hawaiian ones, which are the sweet ones that everybody likes, the ones that look like a light bulb, those can be affected terribly by it. So those are the ones that most people want to grow, and they have the most trouble with that. So anyway, it is technically a genetically modified plant. However, all they did was inoculate it permanently. So I don't have any negative feelings toward growing one of the virus-protected papayas. Now, we haven't carried the other ones, so around the world, they grow other types of papayas, and aren't as sweet as the Hawaiian ones, which we're not so keen on, but there are other ones, Tainung, Red Lady, which is grown a lot in Florida, Sun Gold, there's quite a few, Bala, papayas that were created by universities around the world to stop this virus, but the Hawaiian ones are still sweeter. So the rainbow is the one we want. So what we've had our customers do, and we've done it too, is when you go to Hawaii, get a rainbow papaya. Now they said 80% of the papayas grown in Hawaii now are rainbows because that's all they'll grow. The other papayas get hit by that virus right away and they can't, and it's hard to grow those, although again, there are, I think, one island left where they can grow the other one papayas without any trouble. So we take the seeds out of the rainbow fruit. Now, because it's half virus protected and half not, the offspring have a 25% chance of not having the virus protection, supposedly, if that's the way it's operating. With one protected, one chromosome not, then your offspring can either have two virus protected chromosomes, one or zero. And 25% of them are probably not going to be protected. So it's, so when you buy papayas, you might want to buy more than one. If you're real unlucky, you get two unprotected ones. Now, the other thing about papayas to know is that there are different sexes. sexes in the same flower. So on the Hawaiian papayas, again, those are the smaller light bulb shaped ones, two-thirds of them are hermaphrodite. So generally, if you buy one Hawaiian papaya plant, you should be in good shape. One-third are females, and this less than 1% are male. The differences are the when they start blooming now, these papayas, we're kind of behind in our papaya growing because spring was so cool this year. I mean, March was our winter. Couldn't start the season in March. Even April, it was just so cold in April and May that they weren't growing very well. Finally, they started taking off a couple weeks ago. But it's going to be at least another month before they start to bloom when they're about so big. I mean, once it gets warm, and it's warm now, they grow really fast. Not quite as fast as a pumpkin plant, but they can really take off and get, well, end of this year they should be about this big. And the leaves get a lot bigger, and then what happens at the base of each leaf, they make a flower bud. And the flower buds, now if it's a hermaphrodite, it's generally a long flower bud. Not that big, but long like that. If it's female, it's more of a rounded flower bud. And if it's a male, you get the stalk of flowers that are all little tiny star-like things. Out of the axils in each leaf, they start forming in there. And usually, again, it's about 1.5, 2 foot tall. If they're healthy plants, they start to make flowers. If you get to the end of the year and they haven't made any flowers, you got a virus-infected plant. Even, obviously, even by September, if you're not making flower buds, virus-infected plant. So you know who's fooling around with that. Just pull it out, throw it away. So, again, it's good to plant more than one. The females will still make fruit without the presence of any pollen, but the fruit is seedless and it's kind of small. So if you have either a female near a hermaphrodite or near a male, it'll get pollinated properly. Apparently it's air pollinated or pollinated by real small insects if the bees don't go to them. And they said in most orchards, they'll at least have one male plant. They'll leave one male there, and one male plant, they said, can pollinate the entire plantation. It doesn't take much of the male, because when they bloom, they have lots of flowers. Now, papayas are known to change sexes, although it's usually, if they're female or hermaphrodite, they stay that way. The males, we've seen a lot of males change sexes over the years, where it was male for a while, and then for some reason, after 2 or 3 years, the last flower on the end of the shoot becomes a female flower, and they have fruit on a real long stalk, which is different. So if you get a male plant, you know, you don't, it's not all is lost. They often change sexes. So the hermaphrodite flowers have both the female part, which is the, when they open up, they'll have the female part in the middle, and they'll have the male anthers on the edges, whereas the female flower just has a female part in the middle. The hermaphrodite flowers make the fruit that's shaped like this, and the female flowers make fruit that's shaped like a football. Now on the other papayas, like the quote Mexican types, which really, they're all from Mexico, so it's, say they're different, the bigger ones anyway. Most of them are either female or male. We grew the Maridals for a while. We probably still will have Maridals this year, which is a really good quality Mexican supply. I mean, I ate one 10 years ago from Cuba, that was grown in Cuba. Best papaya I've ever eaten, about this big, red meat. It was quite good, so we've grown seeds from that one ever since. One of my employees still takes the seeds out of his fruit and makes more plants, and I don't know if he's grown them this year or not. Anyway, those turn out male, female, half and half, it seems, about 50-50. So you have to have a female, and it's nice to have a male around, or get a Hawaiian one to call him. Again, if you just have the female, still get fruit, it's a little smaller, no seeds. It's hollow inside, so it is. Fruit takes about 8 months to ripen. So, now if you're in the tropics, it only takes 4 months to ripen, but because we're interrupted by winter, so they bloom heaviest in the summer, then winter comes, nothing happens, and they ripen the next spring. So if we didn't have a winter, it would be probably 4 to 6 months to ripen. But because we've got that winter, it drops below 80 degrees during the daytime for like 4 or 5 months, then everything just comes to a halt. The fruit just hangs there, it doesn't do anything. So usually we see them ripening at the earliest, late winter, early spring. But the fruit that ripens more toward the warm weather usually tastes the best. Warmer it is, the better it tastes. Although, you know, we've had these warm winters. I was at Andy Bernal's house a few years ago, and he has a wine pine in his backyard. And I was there in February, and we picked the fruit off this wine pine. It was fine, it was good, but that was 2014, and that was a warm winter. So, warm winters are helping. The fruit tastes better on those. So generally, they just stay as one stalk. Again, about 3 foot of growth a year. They don't usually branch unless the top breaks off or something happens. So they keep going straight up. They keep making flowers, and then the fruit ripens over time. So you have leaves at the top, new flowers at the top, and then if you go down the trunk, the fruit is larger and larger until it's ripe. And they were hanging with each where the fruit leaves are attached, but the leaves usually fall off before the fruit is ripe on the leaves here. So 3 foot a year after about 4 or 5 years, it's getting kind of tall. Occasionally they'll branch out down here and we'll start over with the branch that makes fruit lower, or you can cut the top off and start them up again. Sometimes if you have one that really attains it, because when these are seed grown, every seed is genetically different. So you can get a lot of variety among the offspring as far as quality and everything goes. So if you happen to get a good one, you might want to just cut the top off and let it re-sprout if it gets too tall to pick. And generally we want a nice hot spot in the yard. They like it hot. So the south side of the house, they need well-drained soil. So if you have sandy soil like Santa Ana or Garden Grove or areas like that, it's pretty simple. But if you've got clay, either put them in a big pot or make a little mound of sand for them to grow on. We grow them in pots. You know, this is a little bit small. I'd say the next size up. This is a number 15 squat. The number 20 squat pot we've done them in, which is about 20 inches across or so, about this big, and grown a full size of wine papaya in it. Good quality fruit in a pot that size. We had the plant, making sure the drainage was good. It was in straight pumice rock. It's 100% pumice, but we did have a drip system on it. It was getting watered every day, or even more than once a day, because pumice doesn't retain that much moisture. We were fertilizing it every week. We grow quite a few papayas in 15-gallon nursery in our top pot. The problem with papayas is more wet, cold soil than the cold air on the plant. So we've had some frosty winters and it hasn't hurt the plants that much, but if it's wet and cool in the wintertime, they often rot and fall out. And be careful where you are located. We had a customer in the canyon area. Two winters ago, not this last one, but 2 winters ago, they had a 15-gallon one in a pot this size. But in our backyard's a small canyon, and it did get cold enough and killed it. Killed the root system. So even though we've had warm winters, if you're not in the right spot, you know, if you're on a very hilltop, you're good. If you're in Costa Mesa, Fountain Valley, the temperatures are pretty mild. It's interesting, the areas around the Orange County for what the temperatures do. Like, we drove a number of years ago, this was probably 10 years ago, we drove from my mother's house in Mission Dale, it was 44 degrees, to Costa Mesa, 57. Playas are okay with 57, they do not like 44. Or I think it was 42. So there was a 15 degree difference in 10 miles there. So there's different areas around Orange County that definitely stay warmer than other areas in the wintertime. So definitely you see more papayas in this area doing well than you do on the edges of Orange County.
So with the weather like this, how often, it's been pretty hot. How often should you water?
Well, evenly moist is the key, so water them a little bit every day. Okay. They don't use a whole lot of water, but it doesn't get
too. Okay. And then what fertilizer were you using?
We use a palm food.
Okay.
I don't know, we generally have to use the Osmoco, this palm fertilizer. But there's nothing wrong with, you know, organics like Dr. Fruit Tree, that should work fine too. But we've grown some quite good fruit with just the, with just the palm fruit. It's that one here. And it made good fruit.
Do they ripen on the tree?
Yes.
They do. So that's like.
Yeah, when they're turning yellow, you pick them.
Oh, will it still be hard then?
Still firm. I think they fall off before they get soft.
Oh.
Okay, the plants we have, they're called Rainbow. Well, this is Peruvian red, that's different. Don't look Peruvian red. My daughter would have to tell you if that's a larger fruit, that's not as sweet or a smaller fruit. So anyway, if we put Rainbow in here, it's not really Rainbow, it's an offspring of Rainbow, it's second generation. Which again means that 3/4 of these should have the virus protection, and 1/4 probably does not.
How do you get the seeds?
Prove that it's labeled Rainbow.
Oh, you just go in the market and buy some
fruit? Well, they only sell it really in Hawaii. You take a trip to Hawaii, find some fruit at the store that says Rainbow on it. Get a rainbow papaya, eat the fruit, save us, bring us.
The seeds seem like they're a little moist, round, horrible. I mean, do they dry up or?
Yeah, so the way the seed is built, they're about this big, but if you look at them closely there, the seeds are kind of this shape with little they're not spines, but they're little things sticking out. And they're surrounded by a gel sac.
Yeah.
So what we normally do when you can just put that in the sun, the moisture will dry up and it'll still be fine. Or you can just squeeze them with your fingers and then the sac bursts and the juice works out and then you dry them after that. So, and the seeds tend to live about 5 years and you keep dry. The offspring does. Okay, any questions on the topic? So again, they're not the most sure bet, but we sure like them. And the weather is cooperating. We're getting better weather for papayas than we've had before, because we're not getting the real cold winters, which is messing everything else up, but papayas don't mind. Okay, pineapples. Now, I made the mistake of growing pineapples in the 1980s. So I thought, for a long time I thought, you can't grow pineapples here. Because it was so cold in the 80s, the late 80s, I remember the average December night temperature was 35 degrees. And I planted pineapples, and they just froze. I thought, well, where does it go for pineapples? But after about mid-1990s, I went, well, it's not cold anymore, let's try growing them again. So we grew pineapples in 5 gallon buckets and got fruit that looked just like, and somebody, Mr. Kwan, who died last I think last year it was in Villa Park. He had an article in Sunset Magazine, that's why we started growing him, because he had been growing pineapple in his backyard in Villa Park. And so we started trying them again, and lo and behold, we've got the weather for it, as long as we don't get the unusual cold. So now, we don't sell rooted plants because you can go to the store for a dollar and buy a pineapple, cut the top off, and that's your plant. So it's cheaper to get it that way. Just so you know, the way you do it, I mean, we do have a supplier that does sell papaya plants, but I have to get 72 of them. I don't know if I sell that many papayas a year. But if you cut off the top of a papaya, my grandmother apparently lived in Hawaii when she was younger. She worked at the Dole factory. Dole, I think, was established in 1906. And she was born in Hawaii, I think around 1900. Maybe late 1800s. So she was there when they first started pumping papayas in Hawaii. Pineapples, thank you. And her job was to clean the flesh and take the little seeds and little things off the flesh of the fruit. So she didn't like the pineapples very much later on, because that's all she dealt with when she was working there. But anyway, just take the top off and peel off a number of layers of leaves. Of course, you want to find a pretty decent top that's not all mashed up from shipping. And what most people do, we've done this too, is just set it in a little container of water, clean the water, make sure it doesn't go foul on there, and leave it sitting on a bright windowsill maybe a month or so, and you'll see roots coming out. Once the roots come out, then you just put in a pot of our top pot or pure pumice rock. We've done them with pure pumice too. And then fertilize them. We use the Indus palm food. And it takes them about a year to get a decent size. A year, sometimes 2 years. 2 years max. And in the spring, they send up a flower, actually quite a pretty flower, out of the top of this. So it'll shoot out a flower that's already the shape of a small pineapple, but it's got purple petals on it, so it's quite an attractive flower. And exactly the same size as the ones in the supermarket. Okay, that. Pineapples apparently pretty easily here. We did that in the 90s. One of the reasons we don't like to grow pineapple plants at the nursery is that they're very brittle. You just handle them, the leaves start breaking the leaves. It's almost like, you have to be very careful how to handle them if you're moving them around in the displays. When we're at the farmer's markets, we just gave up. We just said the farmer's markets totally destroyed the pineapple plants that's moving around. But just put them in a pot, put them in a nice hot spot. Black plastic containers they love because of the heat generated in there. So about like this or so, there's about a quarter inch of stem now showing. Maybe I'll cut off a little more of the flesh. And you can start a pineapple plant this by in water this way.
Did you cut off all of the, it doesn't have to have any of the meat of the fruit, right?
Right, it doesn't have to have any meat attached at all.
Okay. I have this issue at my house where every pineapple I start, my dog rips it up and eats it, but now I realize I'm doing it wrong because I'm leaving so much fruit.
when they start the plants that on the plantations, they either take the tops off the pineapples, just like this, or they'll take a side shoot off of the plant in the ground. So this is an interesting plant. So if you look in the flesh of pineapples, a little black thing. So we're wondering if they were actually the seeds or not. So we grew a bunch of them, and we got two pineapple plants from the seeds. Took 7 years to make fruit when you grow from seed. And of course, seeds are like your children, they're not the same, so the fruit didn't turn out as well. So it's better to take the tops off of the fruit or get tissue culture on the plants. But we just want to see if we can do it from seed, and it worked. But yeah, the first year that plant was like this big. So it took 7 years to get size enough to make the fruit flowers and the fruit. Now we've had this for quite a while now. We started the seeds back in 2007, so it had a main rosette of leaves in the center. They made side shoots. This has just been sitting in our greenhouse, so we haven't taken care of it for a long time now since the fruit's not that good. But it's still going. And this can bloom next year and make a fruit on it. But it's, again, the fruit quality wasn't as good as you could get. So. But that's pretty much what they look like. Some pineapples have real spiny leaves. This one is pretty smooth edged. There's one that's sold out there called Sugarloaf. White flesh, very sweet, no core in the middle that you have to worry about, but it's really spiny. They've got a new one that came out this recently called White something. We might just get those in because it's a little bit larger, good sized fruit, white flesh, no core, and smooth leaf. We might bring that up. But of course, you just get the stuff in the store, 99 cents right now, and they're fine. And generally, the plants multiply over time. So, in a 5 gallon bucket, you'll have 3 or 4 rosettes going. That's getting kind of big. You might have to put in a 15-gallon bucket, or you just cut off the side shoots and plant them in their own pots. Because they'll make a fruit in a 1 gallon pot, a full size fruit in 1 gallon. So they don't need that much root space. And about 28 degrees Kelvin. That was in the 1980s when I was growing them. We got that one Bifrost, December 1990. 23 degrees, and all our pineapples turned to mush overnight. So it discouraged us a lot back then, but not anymore. They're fine. Okay, papaya, plumerias. Plumerias are a member of the Apocynaceae family, and that also includes milkweed. So they have a similar shape flower and similar seed pod to milkweed. They are native from kind of western Mexico all the way down. Well, there's different types of plumerias, and there's a lot of relatives all the way from South America. The Olanders are related. There's other plants that are related. Star jasmines are related. And from Africa, the Orissa, the native plums are also related to papayas. Plumeria, you think of it as Hawaiian, but it's more Mexican than anything else. And the plumeria we grow is Plumeria rubra. Rubra means pink. So the wild plumerias have kind of a whitish pink small flower. But pretty much all the colors except for blue and purple you can find in plumeria flowers. And generally the lighter colored ones are more consistently fragrant than the darker colored ones. So this one's Hawaiian yellow. It's not pure yellow, but that's how it looks. Yellow center, white on the edges, on yellow. It's also called celandine, and that is the most popular plumeria because it, the white ones are the yellow one the most prolifically and have a good strong fragrance too. And the fragrance is suntan. Now there's the occasionally. But the growers don't like to grow it because it has, it's not as reliable. So Plumeria obtusa is also known as Singapore Plumeria. They're not Singapore at all, but you see them a lot there apparently. And they have rounder leaves, so the rubras have the pointed leaves, the obtusas have the rounded leaves. Mostly white flowers. In Hawaii they're evergreen, whereas the rubras tend to drop their leaves in winter. Not much other differences, but I've grown the obtusas for many, many years, 20 years we've grown them, but they have a problem in that they're real sensitive to cold. So in the winter, the tips of the branches often die back. They regrow, but they often die back. So a lot of the growers stay away from the Singapore areas. You know, we've had a few years where these just won't be around where it was warm enough for the winter. They didn't drop the leaves and won't be around.
So the obtusa is all white.